Hey, my name is Garrett. I'm working on Strung By Three, a martial arts strategy game where you use stealth and strategy to explore and eliminate. This week I worked on the world, player movement, and some more models, so let's check it out and have some fun. I added a world model into Unity and experimented with some other designs. I really like that there's three distinct tiers, and that's going to work well for the level design, but I also want to experiment a little bit more with the kind of shape and actual design of it, such as adding environmental features like walls and water. I'm trying to move my GDD from Google Docs into Hack and Plan itself just to make it a little bit easier to add and modify tasks. I've made most of the general categories, but there's still a lot of work left to do because it is a lot to transfer all 30 some pages of my GDD into another program. I've also spent some time working on the player movement, adding some gravity and jumping abilities. Unfortunately, I didn't get things working as nicely as I would like, so I opted to use the 3D character controller from Unity's 3D Game Kit asset. It might be a bit more complicated to customize in the end, but for what it has, it's perfectly fine for right now, and I don't really want to mess with movement too much. I'd rather get into the combat coding. I saw this video recently from Curtis Holt about Blender procedural models, and I absolutely love it. I played around with combining different modifiers to create these weird but really interesting and cool looking models. It's fast, consistent, and probably better than anything I can model by hand, so I'm really excited to use it. In terms of what I learned this week, I learned that I really don't like coding systems, but much prefer coding gameplay. I kind of got fed up with messing around with the movement code and decided to just use an asset instead. Sure, movement is an important part of the game, but I'd much rather spend that time working on more gameplay intensive stuff, such as the actual combat itself, whereas with the movement, I feel like I'm almost wasting my time spending so much time on it. In my personal attempts though, I did learn more about the physics system and how you should order stuff, so at least I know that for the future. I also learned that Blender is more powerful than I thought. I knew about modifiers before and have used them, but not like this where you combine a bunch of them together to create these procedural models. There are some node-based add-ons to Blender that can make this behavior even more unique and more procedural, I guess. But I'm probably just going to keep it simple for now just with the modifiers and see what I can do with that. I also learned that product organization never ends. I didn't really stay on top of my hack and plan tasks this week because I was focusing on the GDD part, and I realized that it takes a lot of effort to actually manage that. Some issues come up and ideas frequently change, which means I constantly need to reiterate on my GDD and the tasks themselves. I think I need to get more in the mindset that this does happen and it's perfectly fine to happen, but I just need to dedicate more time to managing it. And I'm also learning B-twists, which is kind of hard, but I'm improving a little bit. In terms of what I'm thinking, I'm really loving this procedural modeling and creation aspect. The procedural models by Curtis Holt's tutorial blew my mind and I absolutely love the idea. I think it's because it's a more technical and math-based approach to art, almost like I'm engineering or almost programming art, which I actually really like. Same with the shader graph, how you kind of just organize nodes and functions and processes in a certain order and change up the values, that you create something new, something that maybe isn't as detailed as something that could be made by hand, but since I'm not that great at making stuff by hand, this feels like a better option. After all, I did get really into the shader graph this week with this node-based behavior, making my hyperscape decay effect, which I really love to do, and I'm really liking this idea of using the tools themselves to create art rather than using the tools to allow me to create art by hand, if that makes sense. And I'm also changing the devlog structure yet again. I feel like I have done this for the past 5 or so episodes, but I've kind of got this new structure now. I kind of like the idea of dividing it up into what I actually did, what I learned, and what I'm thinking. It feels a little bit more organic that way, and that's kind of the stuff I end up talking about anyway. I do like to talk about, you know, what I did, but I kind of like to talk about the process as well. And it's kind of more like a learning experience for me, where I'm kind of structuring these devlogs less like a marketing material piece. I mean, it's still like a marketing material piece, but it's also for me to learn and improve and really find out my faults and where I did stuff right and learn from it. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next devlog for some more fun.